Okay, how many of you remember last Sunday we talked about a special meeting service that we're going to have this morning, and I asked for the whole congregation to come out just so that we put you on notice of what's going on. I'm just going to quote from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 so that we are assured we went into the Word of God this morning, in spite of what is to take place. In 1 Thessalonians 5, reading from verse 17, it should come up on the board, so you needn't turn to it. Paul is writing to the church of Thessalonica, and he says, "Rejoice evermore." That's verse 16. "Rejoice evermore. Pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophesying, prove all things, hold fast that which is good. Abstain from all appearance of evil." Now note, he did not just say abstain from evil, but even if it appears to be evil, you abstain from it. "And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly." And Paul says, he prays, "And I pray God that your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ." I read that text to let you know that just as God is concerned about our spirit man, just as he's concerned about our soul man, he's also concerned about the body in which the spirit and the soul resides. As a matter of fact, he tells us in 1 Corinthians that our bodies are the temple of his spirit, that our bodies are not ours to do what we want with it if we have indeed the Spirit of God indwelling us. So this morning, primarily because of the fact that a few weeks ago, perhaps just 3 weeks ago, I did a funeral service here of a young member of the congregation who has left a husband and a little son to grieve because of one small incident. An incident that can happen to anyone, and an incident that happens to quite a lot of people the world over. This incident causes death. And I feel obligated as your pastor to bring all relative information to you so that you can avoid falling into that situation that the dear sister fell into. You can do so innocently if we are ignorant of all the ramifications surrounding what we're going to be talking about this morning. So as to make sure you, as a member, do not fall prey to these things, I have invited two professionals, members of this congregation, but nonetheless professionals, to come and speak to us this morning. Now I know when I do things like this, there are some who would be critical and think that Sunday morning is for the preaching of the Word of God. And that's why I made sure I opened the Bible and I read the Word of God so that those of you who love to be critical of me, you can go right ahead. But my conscience is clear. I've done two things. I have read the Word of God. I ministered a little from it. And I'm doing something to protect your lives. So I'm feeling good about that. Okay? If what is said this morning can save one life, it is more than worth it. As I said last Sunday, I hate funeral services. And you know, as soon as I said that, two people called about deaths in their family. So, this morning, let me do some introductions to you. We have with us one Mrs. Adana Lett. And Adana holds a Bachelor of Science in Biology with specialization in biotechnology and in minors in human resource management from the University of the West Indies. She holds a Master's of Business Management from the Arthur Lockjack Graduate School of Business. She's the Business Development Manager of Rehoboth Limited, a company that offers pest management solutions, structural renovations, and landscaping. She's responsible for research and development and training, and also serves as secretary of the board, I guess, of her company. Prior to joining Rehoboth Limited, Mrs. Adana Lett served in the Human Resource Department in the Ministry of Science, Technology, and Tertiary Education, and a qualifier as recruiting officer and claims examiner, respectively. During her 12 years of work, she has also accumulated certification in customer service, communication, and negotiations. She was honored with the Rehoboth Star Award for portraying company's values, dedication, and excellence in customer relationships. She was also awarded with the Dale Carnegie Breakthrough Award. In her passion to serve, she joined the outreach group Radiance Arts Group that brought the message of salvation and hope in song, dance, and drama locally and across the Caribbean. I dare say this morning, in spite of that fact, Adana is not here to dance for us, but rather to give us some life-saving information. On the other hand, her father, Mr. Worley Lett, has over 25 years experience in business and pest management solutions. He has a diploma in structural pest management and pest management certification from PMATT and the University of the West Indies, respectively. During his years of service in Rehoboth Limited, which incidentally is their company, a registered pest control company, he has also accumulated certification in procurement, handling and marketing of agricultural chemicals from SBCS and the University of the West Indies. Through Rehoboth Limited, Mr. Woolley Lett is a member of the international organization, National Pest Management Association, NPMA internationally. He is the project manager of Rehoboth Limited, responsible for planning through closure of external projects. Mr. Lett also functions in the marketing department. As joint owner of Rehoboth Limited, he serves on the board as a director with the specific role of chairperson. He was honored by Rehoboth recently with a long service award for loyalty, dedication, hard work, and continuity. Those words sound like music to my ears. In his passion for humanity and to serve the community, he founded the Uncompromising Truth of a radio program that sings the message of Jesus Christ, the life and power of salvation. It's a journey and it's kingdom benefits. So that we have these two professionals here with us this morning. What was the problem? The problem was someone lost their life by a rodent who urinated somewhere and who contaminated something that our dear sister ingested, and in a matter of 3 days, she was gone. Where that took place, what's the name of the sickness? leptospirosis. This can happen to anyone, and we need all the information we can get so that we can preserve our whole spirit, soul, and body for the Lord Jesus Christ. So I'm going to ask them both to come this morning, both Adana and Worldly, and if you can just put your hands together. They are members of this congregation, so you needn't stand. After the presentation, we are going to have a question and answer period just to make sure we get everything clarified and you don't leave here being ignorant of anything, okay? I am going to leave the platform. I want to sit there and get all the information I can get. So I can comfortably leave them in charge.
Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me? Okay, it's an honor to be here to speak with you this morning on this topic because it's very important to us at Rehoboth Limited to save lives. This morning, the presentation will be entitled Rats and Mice, Vectors of Disease. Just before we start, I'd like to ask if the questions coming after the session will be pertaining to the content, because as Pastor said, we do also have a question and answer section. Okay? Across the world, there are two different categories of diseases. There are infectious diseases and non-infectious diseases. 25% of deaths across the world are responsible or caused by infectious diseases, and a quarter of these, or half of these, are found in the developing countries. Historically, we have encountered rodents where they have brought us three major plagues. The Justinian Plague, which began in 541 AD and killed 25 million people. Next was the Black Death, originating in China in 1334. This spread along all the great routes of Europe and was responsible for killing 60% of the European population. Next on the agenda was the Modern Plague. This began in China in the 1860s and caused 10 million deaths over 20 years. This is a map that shows the historical data of those three plagues. If you look at the red arrows represent the range of the Justinian Plague, the green arrows represent the Black Death, and the blue arrows represent the Modern Plague. Plague is still a problem in the world. As you can see by this map, it shows the different areas that plague has infested up to this day. You have more than 10,000 deaths centrally located in South Africa and parts of the South American continent. The pictures you see there are pictures of bubonic plague, septicemic plague, and pneumonic plague. There are 4,660 species of rodents. Now, these rodents are not limited to just rats, mice. As you will see, some of your friendly furry creatures may also be rodents. They include chinchillas, squirrels, hamsters, pocket gophers, chipmunks, packer or lap, the local lap, nutrias, false pacarana, capybaras, beavers, and our local agouti is also a rodent. Also, the famous porcupine. Yes, the answer, I'm hearing you all asking the question, Do these furry creatures harm us? Yes, they do. They are reservoirs of plague as well. Now, the common rats and mice that we face in Trinidad are of two species. You have the brown rat or Norway rat called Rattus norvegicus, the black rat called Rattus rattus, and the house mouse, Mus musculus. Yeah, don't be fooled. They're deadly. Okay. So rats or rodents are called commensal organisms because they live in association with human beings. Now, commensal is an ecological definition, which probably is misleading because it leads us to believe that humans benefit from our association with rodents, but we don't. Because of that, by public health standards, they are termed synanthropic rodents because their associations brings us disease. Let's look at the mice rats behavior and biology now. This is a life cycle of rats. Let's look at some characteristics of rats and mice. The lifespan of a rat ranges between 9 to 18 months. They become sexually mature between 2 to 3 months, and they can have up to 10 offspring 7 times per year. The colony size of the Norway rat is 100 to 150 members. The colony size of black rats are 60 members. They are nocturnal creatures, and they eat up to 30 grams of food per day. Rats must also drink water regularly. They must stay hydrated. Now, in contrast, mice now, they have about the same lifespan, but they become sexually active more frequently, within 6 weeks. They have 5 to 6 offspring and 8 litters per year. They are also nocturnal animals, and they eat 3 grams of food per day. They do not need to drink water because they get their water from the foods that they eat. Just want to identify something that was important, the numbers of the colony size. Now, when we see one rat, you know definitely that it's not one rat you're seeing, okay? That's the colony size that's backing that individual. So these are the environments that are conducive for rats' habitation. They love to be protected from the cold, heat, wetness, and from predators. You can therefore find them on the sidewalks, riverbanks, burrows in soil, trees, sewer lines, building voids, basements, and roofs. These are some areas that you may find them. See the burrow hole there, and the roof. And the familiar bamboo patch. Some environments that are conducive for mice include warm, dark, and secluded areas, and the presence of nesting materials such as paper, cupboards, cardboards, cotton, and insulation. Where do mice live? You may find mice in wall voids, ceiling voids, within upholstery, crawl spaces, basements, garages, burrows, and nests. And here are some areas where you may be able to see them as well. This picture shows some common rodent entry and harborage locations that will be expanded by Mr. Lett later. Note the tree, garbage, spaces beneath the door, holes in the roof, ceiling vents, and also livestock. Important as well is pet food. Pet food. The common signs of rodent activity include droppings, gnawing damage, smudges, smears, or grease marks, urine stains, and odors. This diagram shows the different sizes and shapes of droppings, gnawing activity, fabric, holes in the wall, and wiring. And these are evidence of the urine stains there. These are the smudges and smear marks. Rats, mice, and disease. Rats and mice are vectors of disease. What is a vector? A vector is any organism that transmits pathogens to human hosts. This is a definition given by the University of Washington School of Public Health. There are over 40 diseases spread by humans from rats. Rats are associated with ectoparasites. Ectoparasites include fleas, mites, and ticks. They are also associated with endoparasites, and as well bacteria and viruses. Some endoparasites are responsible for diseases such as the bubonic plague, Lyme disease, murine typhus, rickettsial pox, ticket-borne relapsing fever. Endoparasites include hookworms, tapeworms, pinworms. Bacteria include leptospirosis, listeriosis, Q fever, rat bite fever, salmonellosis. And viruses include hemorrhagic fever, hantavirus, Lassa virus, and lymphocytotic chorioamnionitis. Let's take a look at leptospirosis. Leptospirosis is caused by the bacterium Leptospira enterobans. Leptospira is characterized by causing disease-causing spirochetes. The diagram here shows the helical structures of the spirochetes. These are the disease-causing bacteria responsible for harm in humans. Leptospirosis is a zoonotic disease, which means it is transmitted from animal vectors to human hosts. Leptospirosis is endemic worldwide to subtropical and tropical regions with high rainfall and high humidity. The disease is often mistaken for influenza, viral hepatitis, typhoid, malaria, and particularly dengue, as these diseases also coincide with the peak in rainy season. Trinidad and Tobago leptospirosis statistics were obtained from the National Surveillance Unit, Ministry of Health. In 2001 to 2008, 1,545 leptospirosis cases were reported. 250 of these between 1998 to 2008 were confirmed by lab tests. This is a map of the distribution of leptospirosis cases within that period, 1998 to 2008. If you look, you will see that there's a peak in Sandy Granny, a maximum of 10 cases within that period. Another important map would be flood risk areas. Sandy Granny is located here. Do you all see a pattern? A pattern between the flood areas and also the occurrence of leptospirosis? Look at it. Notice? Right. So that is evidence that there's a relationship between flooding and the disease. Two more important maps will be the ones that follow. This is a diagram of the annual mean rainfall for that same period, 1998 to 2008. You see, there are high rainfall levels in this area, the same area as you saw in the map. And also, you're looking at soil drainage impediment. The highest level of soil drainage impediment is around this area. So three factors are important for the spread of leptospirosis: soil drainage, rainfall, and flooding. This information was related by Jacob Upadhyay. This is a global map of leptospirosis outbreaks between the year 1970 to 2008, provided by Munoz Zanzi. We see the distribution across South America and certain regions of China and Europe. And we understand now why they would have been occurring in those areas. So what is public awareness like for leptospirosis in Trinidad? A KAP survey was done on 800 households. Only 52.4% ever heard of leptospirosis, and half of that 52.4% did not know what the signs of the disease were. Unfortunately, 82% of all the participants were involved in at least one high-risk activity, which included mostly walking barefooted outdoors. How much of us are guilty of that? So how do we detect or diagnose leptospirosis? It is done in three ways. The first way is through direct observation. It is not recommended. Although it's cheap, it's very non-reliable because it's very difficult to see the leptospira bacteria under the microscope, and therefore you can get a false negative. The next would be antibody tests. There are several of these, but the superior one is called the MAT, MAT, or microscopic agglutination test. It uses patient samples and applies the leptospira bacteria to the sample, and if the antibodies are present, then they would clump. There's a disadvantage with this test, however. In acute cases of leptospirosis, the antibodies are very low or absent, so you may also get a false negative. So in lieu of that, there's the DNA test. PCR, or polymerase chain reaction test, is the gold standard with respect to identification. It actually identifies the DNA structures of the leptospira virus. The disadvantage is that it's very expensive, and so is the equipment, and it may not be available. Another disadvantage is it's unable to detect the concentration of the bacteria, but it's really good because even if it's in small quantities, you'll be able to get a positive test. How is leptospirosis transmitted? There are two modes of transmission. Direct transmission occurs when the host is directly infected by an animal. Indirect transmission occurs when the host comes into contact with infected water or food. Do you all recognize this picture? Where is that? Okay. So don't go wading through those waters, okay? So some portals of entry on the human body are the eyes, the nose, the mouth, and cuts and abrasions on the body. So if you go wading through those waters, and some of that water comes into contact with these portals, you may become infected. What are the ideal conditions for the leptospira bacteria? Well, we know that moisture is one. The other two is pH and temperature conditions. The leptospira bacterium is active at neutral to slightly alkaline pHs. It is alive and active at temperatures under 42 degrees Celsius. Temperatures above 42 degrees Celsius and at 55 degrees Celsius, they are killed. So foods are considered to be safe at 100 degrees Celsius. How can we destroy this bacteria? It will be destroyed by strong acids and strong alkaline, such as acetic acid, citric acid, chlorine, iodide, lysol, and seawater. Yes, seawater. Just to reiterate some risk, which Mr. Lett will expand on, walking barefooted in damp conditions or damp soil, gardening with bare hands, and exposure to pets that have been infected, such as dogs. There are two types of leptospirosis. There's the mild version, which is called the anecteric leptospirosis, and the severe version, which is called ecteric leptospirosis, or Weill's disease. In anecteric leptospirosis, there are two phases. Phase one, which is intermediated by asymptomatic period, and phase two. Death from this infection is very rare. In phase one, you may experience intense headache, fevers above 40 degrees Celsius, chills, nausea, vomiting, red eyes, and muscle pain. This is followed by the asymptomatic period. These are some of the conditions. The asymptomatic period may last between 1 to 3 days, where the patient is symptom-free and appears to have recovered. In phase two, there's the onset of meningitis, nausea, vomiting, headache, photophobia or light sensitivity, uveitis, and skin rash. This occurs 0 to 1 month after phase one. The symptoms of anecteric leptospirosis. Here you see the inflammation of the brain there and the uvea and photosensitivity. Recovery occurs within 6 to 12 weeks, or it may take a couple of years. And just because you've been infected once by leptospirosis, it doesn't mean that you can't be infected again in the future. Weill's disease, severe leptospirosis or ecteric leptospirosis. There's a high chance of fatality with this form of leptospirosis. Mortality rate is between 5 to 10% and even higher in developing countries. It is also characterized by two phases, but there's no intermediary phase. There's an unclear demarcation between the two phases, so they can roll into one. Phase one is the leptospiremic phase, and phase two is the immune phase. These are some conditions that may occur. Intense headaches, fever, chills, nausea and vomiting, diarrhea, red eyes, muscle pain. Heart conditions include myocarditis, pericarditis, congestive heart failure, and arrhythmias. Kidney failure is also involved, jaundice of the liver, enlarged liver, and liver failure. This is some examples of hemorrhaging and jaundice. Medical treatment. The mild infection of leptospirosis may be treated by oral intake of antibiotics such as amoxicillin or doxycycline. However, the severe infection, Weill's disease, is treated intravenously by antibiotics such as penicillin or ampicillin. Blood transfusions and dialysis may also be required. The recovery time for this type is 6 to 12 weeks, However, if the disease is captured too late and there's too much damage to internal organs and hemorrhaging, that may still arise. Right, and that brings us to the end of this section. These are the references, and I'd like to say thanks to Sahara Curry and Wildelet for assisting with this presentation. I now turn over to Mr. Wildelet, and he will take you through the preventative measures.
My part is sort of a simple, she make it much simple for me today. And one thing I would like to say is that I'm glad to see that you are still seated. Because many times when you have anything like rapt demonstrations and so on, which at one time it was taking place in my office where we are doing a sort of organization, something standards and so on we are doing there. And we had this young lady who came to do this demonstration for us, and the course she was given, she came to teach us certain things about the world standard something. And she was asking about how do we analyze the rats and so on, and what are the habits and so forth, and what did they do? So she said, want us to explain. So I was just explaining normal. And but in explaining it, we have to take her straight to a site for myself while we're in the office. So I can sort of bring her mind to the site, what took place on the site. So I told her, well, when we go there, we see the infestation and so on. We look to see the signs of them and if they are present. So once we find it is daytime and they are present, we know that they have a major problem. So we explained it to her, well, you know, the rats will come out of the hole and they will be running and so forth. And she was there. And when we started to talk about the rat, she was just, her hands start going up to her head and she started going to her mouth. Then her feet start coming up to her chest. And all of a sudden, well, I just noticing that, but not really recognizing that she's that kind of scared of the rat per se. So when I told her, well, the rat came and they just run up and they just run over our heads and tap the land. All I could hear was a big shriek, "Rrr!" And she fly through the door, straight through the door and outside. You see? It had no rat in my office, but I was just explaining to her what takes place on the field. You see? So it's a nice thing that we can fear that. You know, all the Bible say, fear not anything. But it was a good thing that we know that we can fear. This is something that we recognize on the field that that most Trinidadians, they fear rat. In a sense, especially women fear rat, which is a, in quote, very good thing because we'll know how to take care of ourselves and our home and so on. And we'll be a little more careful, especially in our workplaces and business and so on and recreational areas. You see? So it's a good thing because it will tell us how we will walk in P's and Q's concerning this rat because it's very dangerous. I want to go into something here to show you about homes because I have here concerning our homes, which is our personal spaces, our workplace, and recreational places. You see? Because a lot of time we at home, we tell ourselves we can do anything we at home. But depending on what we do, it's going to be dangerous for us. So, integrated pest management is one of the most critical and important part of it, when dealing with rats or rodents in this kind of sense, right? But rats is something that we want to pay attention to a whole lot because it is so dangerous. It's dangerous to the extreme. It's going to the exponential curve, okay? So I want to bring it to you here to tell you the areas that you have to be careful home, around your home. No clutter must be around your home. Avoid any clutter around your home because if it's around your home, they will get inside the home. Okay? Disposal of your garbage. Okay? Don't keep it too long inside. Don't put it in your yard. And make sure when it's placed outside that you monitor your garbage on the outside. Even though your neighbors put in garbage on the outside, make sure to monitor that. And the simplest thing I can tell you to do, if your neighbors ad hocly dispose of garbage, make sure to have two things at hand. Make sure to have disinfectant and bleach. Always. That's supposed to be in your home. 100% of the time. And don't have it by the little small thing. Have it by the gallons. Once you know rats are present, you understand? Make sure to have that. When we walk in, that I want to say to expand on that. If you notice that any rat is in your home or external of your home, remember I spoke to you telling you about your clutter? Avoid things against your home. Avoid any trees growing up against your house and going to attach to your ceiling, or any branch from any neighbor coming to your house or in your yard touching your roof. It is dangerous. What happens, I will explain to you what happens. The rat, which is the roof rat, it normally climb the tree and get inside your ceiling because they want high ground to nest, okay? And it will be very dangerous for you when they go inside of there, because rat and their tooth, the fangs, it grows very fast. And they need things to gnaw on to cut down that teeth, otherwise it's gonna kill them. They won't be able to eat and they're gonna die. So the idea of the gnawing is not really to make nest per se only, but it's to get the teeth grind down so the teeth won't kill them, okay? So we are fortunate, our own does not grow that way, you understand? So we don't have to gnaw against things. So we have to watch at these things. And the thing is with the rats, when they gnaw to grind their teeth down, they gnaw against your electrical installations. And you know if you have a wooden roof, that's what's gonna happen. You will easily be barbecued and you don't even know. Okay? Right? The whole house could catch a fire and that is good. That is it. You understand? Because they must gnaw against things to get the teeth down. Right? This is what I'm going to tell you concerning when you have animals now around your home, dogs especially, and you're feeding dogs, or maybe you have chickens or things in your things like that. You have your pets and so on, and you have feed. Your storage of your feed in your home, around your home, where they have the chicken coop, where you have the dog kennel, or the case may be, your food for these areas must be put away properly, away high up from the ground, and you have to monitor, because you don't know how your neighbor keep their places, so you have to monitor that any rats come inside. You will not see them all the time, because they come in, they are nocturnal, so they move only at night. But you have to be careful, because most of the time, if they get in any food inside by you, they will stool there. If they pee there, you might know. So be careful, as you heard me say before, avoid walking bare feet. Once you live against a drain, close a drain, just avoid walking bare feet in your yard, please, okay? The storing of your food for the animals, make sure that when you're feeding them, that the animal eat clean. If you know your dog can only eat 1 pound, don't give it a pound and a half. You understand? Because they say, well, I'm going out for the whole day and I won't be back until the night. I will give them a whole hotototo of feed. You understand? And you know what's going to happen? They're going to eat and they're going to leave back. And when they leave back, the rats get the feed. The thing is about when the rats come in and they get the food, they're going to look for some way to stay, to build their home. And once they build their home, well, you are in really, real, real big trouble. Real big trouble. Because to get them out is not so simple. It's something that is very costly. So before, take the precautions in front. So feed them a little bit. And when you come home, if you come home late at night, feed them a little bit more in the morning and so on. So make sure that it's clean, they eat clean, and put away the utensils. It's very, very serious that what we do, the first thing you're supposed to do when you get up in the morning to feed the animal, you feed them early. So by the time you're ready to leave, the container that they eat food in, not where they drink in water, where they eat the food in, that will be put away, because the rat will just come and they will just lick whatever inside of there and it will be good enough for them. Okay? And wherever the rat pass, they pee at the same time. So if a rat running from here to the back there, it will pee about maybe 50 times or 60 times going up there. Reason being that rats don't see very well. They song and they hear things and the whiskers, they sense things very fast with that. Okay? The hair and the skin feel the vibration up to about 50 feet away. So if you just swing the corner there and it's 50 feet away, they don't know that you are there already. They don't feel the vibration already. So they're going to sense that and they're going to run away. Okay? That is just for one part. Sometimes they don't run away. And I'll tell you why they don't run away. When you have an infestation, they don't run away. You understand? Because I could tell you, being in the field and so on, places that you visit, especially 100% of the time is restaurant. Very little home, but restaurants. Restaurants that based on their ground time, ground levels, like to walk in from the pavement to those places, I'm going to tell you something, saints of God. Be 100% careful. Those in malls and the upstairs building, you are okay. Up to a point. Okay, up to a point. But you have to be very careful in eating these areas. Persons that are selling food by the roadside and food is prepared home, you don't know. So that is something that you have to make that judgment call. So many times we have to pray a lot. You understand? We have to pray a lot. You know, Pastor always call us out to pray, and we don't really come out to pray. You understand? I say I am. You understand? You understand? So we have to concentrate on that, because remember something, eh? In Hosea 4:6, the word of God tells us, God spoke about his people. Eh? He said, my people. He did not tell you about the world. He said, my own people. What happened? Perish for what? Did he stop there? What else? You forget that. Because they reject knowledge. You understand? Because you reject knowledge, that is what will happen. You see, we have to be very, very careful. This is something not to be played with. Because in our field, in our workmen, we always have our PPEs. Making sure that they did not get contaminated. Because where we work, it has, a lot of times you get in contact, you get a abrasion, you get a cut, you get a scrape and those things. And in dealing with that, you can get contaminated. So we always have to be very careful. So we always let that come at first frontwards. As we say, always have bleach at hand. Again, when we buy drinks outside or foodstuff, fruits, we say we don't need to wash it because it's a fruit. But you know, sometimes when we buy things like bananas, I will say sometime my wife long ago, she normally peels it off and hold the banana and start to eat. That is something we don't do at all. Right? So when you have your banana, you make sure you peel your banana and you eat. Okay? So you'll be safe with that. So you don't do that. Right? You peel it and you hold the skin down here. You don't peel it right off. You peel and you eat and you peel and eat. Right? And if anything, you can just bite off the top and just throw it away and you can eat. But things like orange and grapes and those things, don't take it and just pop it in your mouth. Because a lot of time when they store these things, rats run in those areas. Okay, if it come out from the cold storage, it's okay. But once it has reached and is stored by those persons that sell, the vendors, it will be contaminated very easily. Because the rat will go on there. And wherever they go, they pee at the same time to mark this. But the thing is with rats, what they pee for, the reason that they pee, because they mark their spot where they pee. That is their territory. And they will be able to sense that to keep on that part, because as I told you, they don't see very well. So they go to smell these spots and to go along these parts. You know, see? That is why I tell you to have the bleach and to have the disinfectant. Right? Again, when we buy the drink now, do not open the cork and put your mouth on it just like that. If you can just, that line that have the little piece that remain, don't ever. If you have to drink, if you're that thirst and you have to drink, please don't let your lip touch that line. That, you know, when you take off the cork, you have a little piece of plastic remain. Your lip must not cross that under no circumstances, if you don't have a straw and you have to. Okay? Under no circumstances. You understand? Do not suckle on the bottle. Right? 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 So I just say that so you know you could get to understand how serious it is. Because when we were doing the course at UE, and they were telling us about a guy that went in a cellar, that is downstairs a basement. And he just went and he just pulled off a conker, he just put his mouth on a bottle because it was beer. He just pulled it and he just take out the cover and he drank. He never made it upstairs because down there was so contaminated. And just last week, I heard from one of my customers in Port of Spain. Next to her have a business that sells food. The guy was there, and he was eating and just rest down his sandwich. The owner of the business rest down the sandwich just to help somebody lift something to bring it across. He never made it home, saints of God. He never made it home. He dropped, as soon as he finished eating the sandwich, he dropped right there. Take him to the hospital. That's the end of it. So I bring it home that you will know the seriousness of it when we have to buy things outside, because outside there is very, very dangerous. Because the Norway rat lives under drains. Okay? And they pee very, very much. And everywhere they go, why they pee any food? They want to mark that that is my own. Don't come there. You understand? So this is what we face as saints of God. We face these things out there. So I just want to bring it home to you to let you know the kind of seriousness about these things. We have to know that if we see rats in our homes, two things. It's either you call the professionals or you make sure you have your shoes on and you have gloves on to deal with them. If you don't understand what it is about, just call the professionals and you will be guided concerning that, because your health is more than the wealth. You understand? Because if you don't have your health, you can't really, because many times you have the wealth and you can't really buy the health with it after that. You know, it don't work like that. All right? I say no. If you design to buy food on the outside, make sure if you're not certain about how clean the kitchen is, you will look at how the floor as you walk inside is. Look at the windows and look at every crease and every corner. You see the grime pack up there. You know that is the place it's to just your back is supposed to be there, right? Right? So whatever you see there, because in my field, working on the field, all the time I go into places. Once I walk inside, if they call us to do a site visit of specialty restaurants, and from time I walk inside the front door and I see it, I know what's going on. It's 10 times worse in the back. So once you see that grime on the floor, you know what's going on in the back. Because many times you come and you stand up there because you just want to get your food, right? You just want to get your meals. But you're not seeing because that counter that they have to see inside the kitchen area is sort of a high. You won't see what's going on the ground there. But if you know what goes on the ground there, you will surprise. You will very much surprise. So look at these are the telltale signs for us to look at when we go into these areas. I want you to look now at and these areas, if you don't have a proper effective exclusion, you won't be able to do anything with that, right? You wouldn't be able to deal with it. Now, for professionals now, persons who work in, like plumbers, service technician, pest control, as we are now, janitorial, sanitation, and those persons, masons and carpenters, be aware when those who fix in fridges and stoves and those kind of thing, or working inside a roof and seeing body plumbing areas and so on, please wear your PPEs, because these are the areas where the rat normally congregate. These are the areas that find a lot of the toxicity in those areas concerning that. Okay? So when you have to go under the fridge and the stove, have your gloves on, because you will get contaminated there. And remember something, you will only have approximately about around 3 days. That is what you have, and you wouldn't know that you are sick. Okay, you wouldn't know anything at all. That is the thing with leprospirosis. It doesn't know anything until it's too late, right? So the time that whenever they find it out, that is the end of you. Okay, so this is the end of what I have to say here. If there's anything, you will ask us whatever question that you need. I hope we were expansive enough. And whatever wherever we have left out is maybe just for you to come in there to ask anything based on that. But we want you to be fully educated and be able to take all the precautions concerning your health. All right? Thank you.
Anyone asking questions?
Good morning. I have two questions. Is vinegar another cleaning agent?
Yes, I think that may fall under acetic acid.
Okay, good. What about, you spoke about two different modes of leptospirosis. Is there any particular rodent that causes one versus the other?
No, leptospirosis may be formed in the rodents, all of them that we identified, and also animals that may be infected.
I just wanted to know, you said we should wash wash the top of the cans and or the milk and whatever. Simple washing is sufficient? Just wash and let it
no.
pipe, is that sufficient?
Very good question.
Has come in contact with, you know.
Yes, right? Very good question. That is the part that I wanted to hear somebody ask. Based on whenever you have to wash, try your best to wash with liquid soap. Use liquid soap to wash your bottles and your cans when you buy them in the groceries. Do not put the cans inside your pantry except they are washed, please. Okay? And use liquid soap. Based on the hard soap, where they're washing your hands, the hard soap it has a lot of wax, and the wax will help seal whatever it is inside your skin or whatever it is. So use the liquid soap, okay?
Also ensure that the cans are dried before you put them away.
Good morning. Thank you so much for the information. Two questions. I noticed the Lyme disease, the rodents with the Lyme disease. If your dogs come into contact with it, could it be transferred to you? And if humans come into contact with the disease, could it be transferred from human to human as well?
Okay, Lyme disease is associated with ticks, the ticks that live as ectoparasites on the rats. If these ticks can be transferred to the dogs and other pets, they may also bite human beings. I think we all recall Lyme disease from the deer incident in the US as well. So that's how they would have been infected. I hope that answers your question. Anything else? You'd have to, that's a kind of technical question, but you'd have to get in contact with the blood of the infected person. And if, remember, if they're in the acute phase, they may not have that much antibodies. So it has to be direct blood contact. It's not found in, you wouldn't get it from saliva. Okay?
Yes, so any other question there?
Hi, morning. I have a couple of questions. You gave us.
If you're going to ask a question, could you please just stand so we can recognize
yes.
you?
Yes, we are seeing. Yes, sister, you can go ahead.
Yes, you gave us some figures for a couple of years, and it went down. The last one was 250 people who were infected mm-hmm. in Trinidad, right?
Yes.
Is that figure dropping or is that rising? And if so, is there an education system in place by any agency to educate people on this sort of information that you're given so that they can take precautions?
Okay, we did visit the Vital Statistics CSO, and they only had confirmed information up to 2008. They said that they are currently trying to weigh through and confirm information from 2010 to now, to 2016. They weren't able to release it. So we don't have that information as yet.
Okay.
What's the other part of the question?
My second question, and I have one more after this. My second question is about the tests that are available, medical tests, when you present your symptoms at a hospital, at an institution in Trinidad. Are these tests done on the spot, or do they wait till probably they tried everything else, and then they try the test, and then it's probably too late?
Okay, I forgot to answer the first part of the first part. It should be the Ministry of Health, and also pertaining to the second question, the prominent test is the MAT test that I spoke about. That's the not the DNA test. That is the one that they use down here, the agglutination test. They take blood samples from the patient and they run it for the first week, and then for the second week, they compare the results to make sure that the person didn't have a pre-immunity. But that may take a while, and that is why we would hope that they would use the DNA test down here. But that's the challenge we listed out in the developing countries.
Okay, thank you. And finally, I heard your Mr. Lett said that they do a lot of management, pest management at restaurants. Do you do domestic homes? And if so, can you give us your phone number to contact you? Thank you.
Yes, we do pest control, but if there's anything, you'll contact me after concerning the pest control matter, and we'll take it from there. So if you have cards, if you want, you'll get that, so you can always contact us after concerning that. Yes.
Hi, good morning. Thanks for the information. I have three questions. The first one, you mentioned how we should wash our tins and bottles. Does that also apply to fruits? What's the best way to wash our fruits before eating them?
Yes, your fruits supposed to be washed before you ingest them, because a lot of time, as I say, the rats will run in all of those areas where they store them, and you can get contaminated with them. You wash them, as I say, with the liquid soap before you place them in your fridge or so.
Okay. Fruits with liquid soap. All right. Second question. So when you're trying to keep, let's say, a kitchen area clean, I would normally use like Lysol, right? Is that sufficient, or should I do a diluted bottle of bleach? And should I also mop with bleach? I don't know if it would damage my tiles or what, but should I also put some bleach in the disinfectant for mopping?
No. I will tell you, no, it's not necessary. What I'm saying here, you don't have to do, you're not actually mitigating anything there per se. But what it is going on there, if you see the rat, if you sense them around, if you know that they are there, then after you do those things what you're speaking about, they're using the bleach and those things can be done on the outside. What it will do, it will help you to keep the rats and them outside, because they will smell something different and they will try to stay away from there. The place will be so smelly.
So how often should we do that? If I wanted to just sprinkle some bleach around the house, how often would you recommend doing that?
You can do that, let me say, every week, weekend, and so on, by when you come home on the weekend.
Okay.
That would be all right.
And my last question, this is my sister wanted to know.
yes, yeah.
Can you name drop, I guess, some establishments, some eaten establishments?
No.
No.
Okay. Good morning. Good morning again.
Morning.
I wanted to find out, rat poison is available in groceries and hardware stores. How effective is it, the rat poison? And sometimes in our homes we tend to use, what we call it, there's a 7-powder. What about the use of 7-powder sprinkling?
Very good question. Very, very, very good question. I will start with the 7 first, because I know everybody wants some 7 to use in their homes. But 7 is carcinogenic, which is cancer causing. It is very toxic. The chemicals that we use is class 4, and that is it is safe for homes and geriatric homes and hospital and so on. But 7 is class 1, which is very dangerous. 7 is only supposed to use maybe the drains or it in the mountains or some kind of thing like that, but not in your home. You don't touch it, you don't get near to it at all. You don't go near to that, absolutely that. And the same is while I'm on this same thing here, I will tell you about the same thing, like your Johnny blocks and so on, carries the same chemical as that. Your Johnny block that you hang in your toilet carries the same things like that. and it's even more dangerous for women and so on when you're hanging those things over your toilet and so on. Do not use Johnny Black at all. You could use the one that turned blue in the water and so on, but Johnny Black carries the same chemical as the 7, which is going to kill you.
Yeah, the Johnny Block is made of camphor.
Camphor, yes, it's camphor, yes. It's camphor.
It's a carcinogen.
It's just like camphor. The same thing like your mud balls. Same thing like the mud balls. Keep the mud balls away from your home. They're not supposed to be in your home. You're not supposed to touch it. Don't put it around your clothes. It is very dangerous.
Correct, yeah.
Very, that's a... Okay. It is considered as a class yes. One chemical, and we were told and by the University of the West Indies that these things we're supposed to let our customers know as often as possible to keep those things away from them because they are very dangerous. Okay.
Good morning.
Morning.
I in connection with the question that my sister asked there. I have some courthouse clothes, so I'll tell you something. Near Massey stores opposite, the salesperson told me who deal with them. Their storeroom is on the floor and is infested with rats from the pavement underground. So beware, brothers and sisters. That's Massey store right and opposite Woodbrook Secondary. Thank you.
Morning. Thanks for such a wonderful presentation. I don't know if this will pertain too much to the ladies, but I know for guys mainly. Because in a household, I grew up with my grandfather being a hunter, so wild meat was a normal thing. You all explained some of the rodents, which was a goody. Now, you also said once food is cooked at 100 degrees.
We don't have any monitor, so I'm not getting...
You're not hearing it.
No monitor. Okay. Yes. Considering wild meat, I know the guys like to adventure with it. You all said agouti, I think that was one of the rodents on the list. From ingesting this or consuming it, can you contaminate such a disease, such as leptospirosis?
If the animal is contaminated with the virus or the bacteria, yes, you may be contaminated. So
okay, guys, so no more eating wild meat, right?
Well, it's important how you prepare as well. If you're gutting and cleaning it, make sure that you're wearing gloves, and also make sure that you cook it to high temperatures above like 100 degrees Celsius, as we spoke about. But it is a risk, so it's a risk you take when you eat wild meat, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
But prepare it well.
I want to finish answering the question to the sister here concerning the rat baits and so on that you'll buy outside and so forth, over the counter. I will say, yes, you can buy it and so on, but again, when you're dealing with rats, I don't like to tell customers that to go and buy something over the counter to do it. If only time you can do that is when you get the population of the rats down, because once you go in and buy that, it means the rats are already inside. Okay? If you're buying that to put somewhere on the outside where the rat, you could kill the rat on the outside, it's fair and good. But again, don't buy that to put inside your home. Get the professionals to deal with it so they can take care of it outside before it reaches inside. Once it reaches inside, you shouldn't be handling it. I just advise that. Yes?
Good morning. I have two questions. One, people love a lot of maniku. And maniku. And the other one is, do you all have a list that you all can distribute to the members of what are the precautions towards the rodent rats and the mice and everything?
Yes, we'll be preparing something for you. We'll have that for you in short notice. We'll have that.
A maniku is a marsupial. It's not a rodent. However, it may also be a reservoir mammal carrying the bacteria, more viruses. So, same precautions.
So, hence the reason that we say if you have to skin the animals and them, make sure to have your gloves on because they will you'll transmit it and sometimes you might skin it, you get a little cut and you'll just transport that and you say, well, I'm going to eat this now, but it has something else going to eat you under there. actually. You understand? So we have to be careful. We have to be careful of that.
Yeah, just one question on the gloves. Normal household gloves they sell in the grocery is sufficient, because some of these gloves are very porous, and when you use them in liquid, your hand gets wet. You know, so is there a particular type of glove?
You will get the gloves, and so remember these gloves are disposable gloves, and you can easily use these gloves. I think they have some little heavier one, some thicker gloves. You can use those. They have it. They have it in, you have that in Hilo and any one of these stores, you can get the thicker ones.
Just cry.
Yes, sister?
Hello, good morning.
Morning.
Things like crabs and even rats attack our ground provisions when the soils are dry. If we do not know and we cook them, would the heat of cooking kill if they are contaminated rats?
Well, again, once the food is cooked up to 100 degrees Celsius and above 42 degrees Celsius, 55 degrees Celsius, they said that it's considered safe. So make sure it's well cooked. That's why rare foods and medium rare foods are not advised.
Good morning.
Morning.
Would we be able to get an idea of the cost? Like if we want to, you know, eradicate it at home, can we get an idea of the cost?
Okay, good question. To deal with rats, because of the nature of rats, the habits are changed very rapidly. So dealing with rats is very dynamic, and we have to do a site visit first to determine the infestation. And because the feeding habits of the rat will operate different, because your neighbor rats will be different from the other one. They all work different. So the rats coming to you, living by you, will operate different from the rats from the neighbor. Yes. Esper? Yes?
Well, a pleasant good morning to everyone. And firstly, I would like to thank, you know, the pastor, first of all, for encouraging this level of conversation, because the Bible spoke about seed knowledge and wisdom and understanding. You know, and you know, I am so, right now I'm, you know, really, you know, I've digested so much this morning in terms of this topic. You know, it has really opened up my eyes. Now, when I look around Port of Spain, and probably Port of Spain is the most infested areas in Trinidad, because the sewer and the sea and everything, because at night time, if you look Frederick Street, there's a whole colony of rats and mice flooding the streets. Now, how safe is those, firstly, those products that people cover down overnight on Charlotte Street and sell for the rest of the year, right? And further, the central market, how safe is that, since most of the produce come in there from Wednesday and Thursday and is covered down and sell to the citizens for Friday, Saturday, and Sunday? Thank you very much.
All right. is the same reason what I told you before, is that even though it is provision and so forth, you make sure that they have no bitten marks on it, that that rat had passed there and so on. And if they were bitten, you don't use that one. If it's whether it's a dashi, a tanya, a yam, whatever it is, you don't take the chances with it at all to eat it, really. And still, when you buy the provision and so forth, just wash it, because you know your hand will be anything. Get the soap water first. If you buy them, you get the soap water first in a bowl or container, and you just pour it into it, and you just turn them up. And then after, you could always rinse it off after or something like that.
Morning.
Yeah. Morning, morning.
Are you hearing me?
Yes, I'm hearing you.
Okay, again, I'm happy that this has been brought up in discussion.
I actually wanted to make a comment more than ask a question, and you could let me know if this is correct. The thing that we really should be worried about when we eat out is more so the packaging, for example, the pizza boxes that have been in storage, the styrofoam containers that have been in storage, are the food that we assume is safe, and then we put the cooked food that might be safe because it's cooked, and then we eat from these containers and assume, you know, all is well. Is that true? Is that comments fair to say?
You mean if the food is
that that is what we should be worried about, the containers that food is put in when we buy food outside?
Not per se, because a lot of time the food is hot food or something that is put inside it. Though they have their own chemicals in it that is dangerous for our health concerning the styrofoam and so on, but we are not discussing the styrofoam and this, but this is more immediate right now for us to deal with, actually.
I was told that a woman passed away from leptospirosis because she bought pizza from a particular place.
Yes, yes.
And the box was contaminated.
If
Price smart.
Yes, this is something that I want you all to be very aware of. Because remember something, is a risk, is a chance that you're taking. It's just a risk. You understand? They are not concerned about, because those places that you call in there, they are not concerned after that, because you cannot hold them responsible for it at all. You cannot stick that on them at all. Because by the time you take it and you ingest it, it won't fall along right there sometimes, all the time. You know, see? And from the time you leave their premises and you fall along, they're not responsible anymore. Though either they might find it in the thing that you had ingested, they wouldn't be responsible after that, because they will say you get it from somewhere, either touch a wall or something, you pick up something from the ground or something, you mash something, you get a cut before or something like that. So all I'm saying to you is to, you have to make the judgment call concerning that. You have to do that. So this is why I am so blessed and thankful for Pastor for bringing this. You know, we have to really give him a round of applause. It's just a demonstration of his love that this is done. Love for us that this is done. Love for us. So we have to recognize that, okay? So I know that my time is already spent. I don't know if I have any more questions or so. But, yeah? One more? Okay. All right. Two more, yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, no questions, really, just to make 2 points. One is the importance of this message. I lost my uncle due to the same disease. He handled some crocus bugs from under his house, and he died shortly thereafter. So that's one. Secondly, I've been involved in sales in Trinidad and Tobago for 25 years. Don't single out Marcy, all supermarkets. No, all supermarkets are, right? They have goods returned to suppliers that they keep there, that they have to get credit for, and that attracts the rats, okay? So all supermarkets are infested in rats, and be warned of all restaurants on the avenue.
That's right.
Okay?
Anyone? Someone else?
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
My question to you, you said you should use the liquid soap to wash everything. But there is something called Condi's crystals that I know we use at home, especially when we buy the vegetables and stuff, we put it to soak before we consume it or we cook it. So I'm just asking if we could continue using the Condi's crystals, and maybe people could probably invest in it as well.
Yes, the crystals, they are good to use the crystals to wash your vegetables. It is okay to use it, but still look at your vegetables to see that it's any part withered, the withered leaves and so on. Try to move them because they might be resting against some other contaminated thing. So pull off your leaves on the outside, just as if you buy cabbage and so on. You take off the top leaves and so on, but make sure to see that the cabbage wasn't bitten in any way at all. So it is good for you to use the crystals and so on. You see?
Thank you.
Okay, I think this is it. Okay, it has somebody else.
I'm not sure if you're aware or if it is that you might be able to answer this question, but I'm still putting it forward. Do you know if at daycare, nurseries or schools or wherever, they give them a certificate that they have been checked? Reason why the little ones drop stuff and you don't know if they are taking the precautions. So as people bringing their children there, if they are aware if that place has been checked by a certificate or something?
I really wouldn't be able to say, but it's supposed to have any places like daycare centers. I think it has a sort of a lack something with maybe the health department, but those places supposed to have a certificate. Once you're dealing with food and so on around, because children eating and dropping things on the ground and so on, that will encourage rats, it will encourage roaches and so on. You're supposed to have a certificate, supposed to.
And if they don't, is there a community, the Port of Spain Corporation, that we could check where? Because if you take your kids there, you want to know they're safe.
Well, what you have to do is, the simplest thing to do is ask for the health inspectors to pay that place a visit, and that they will determine, and they will request that they have a pest controls provider. You see, concerning that.
Thank you.
All right. Okay, that's it? All right. I want to say something. I just want to advise you all that because I'm in this position here right now, we are the provider for this facility here, so you are safe.
Was there someone here, a restaurant owner or something, that wanted to ask a question? You said so? Okay, where is she? I sell her. We're taking this one question because... Okay, let's put our hands for the presenters. Thank you. Could we stand, please? Change this tone for me, please.
Brother Lett, to you and your daughter, on behalf of the members of the congregation, we want to extend a great thank you for what you presented this morning. We are happy and we are proud to know that you're members of this congregation. God has blessed us with professionals in varying areas, and this is one area. Just to let you know that Brother Lett's company, Rehoboth, is contracted by Holiness Revival Ministries to keep rats out of the place, okay? Just very recently, we entered into another contract to make not just the keeping of the rats out, but to make the whole place rat-proof. Isn't that so? Right. So I've been working on that for the past 3 weeks. I don't know if it's completed yet. So whatever you eat in here, feel safe. Now, this morning I asked, how many people of God we have in the place? And I can't help but say I saw one or two hands that was not raised. If indeed that is so, you were honest enough to say that you are not a person of God, I said we are going to give you an opportunity before you leave here to make sure that you are not in the same position that you came in. The gospel of Jesus Christ is a gospel of love. It's enshrined in that one verse, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. God in heaven, recognizing that man has sinned and fallen short of his glory, and there was no hope for him ever in entering into God's heaven when he would depart this earth, out of his love, he sent his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to die so that your sin can be taken care of. Jesus came, he died, he rose from the dead. Now he's offering himself to anyone who would receive him as Lord of their life and as a Savior of their life, to cleanse them from sin, put his Spirit in them, and reconcile us to God. Now, 99% of the church raised their hands. If you didn't, and you are not a child of God, this is your opportunity. And it's not just this church. It's all over the world. God is just taking people out from the road of hell and putting them on the road to heaven. And we can only do so through his Son, Jesus Christ. Why? Because Jesus and Jesus alone, no one else, paid the price for man's sin by giving his very life and being raised from the dead. There is no other person but Jesus through whom you can come to God the Father. So if you were not among those who raised their hands this morning as being people of God, this is your opportunity. You can change that. The hand of the Lord is open wide. He's beckoning people. Come. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. And that's what sin does. We labor at sin. It's a heavy burden to carry. He says, come, and I will give you rest. There is nothing greater in this world than the resting in the assurance that you're one of God's, having the peace of God indwelling you. So if we would just bow our heads, and if there is one, and I kept looking in the balcony while I'm speaking, because I don't know why, but just in the event that you are here, sir, Ma'am, God had an appointment with you this morning. In spite of the fact that we were talking about rats, God had an appointment with you, sir. He had an appointment with you, ma'am. It's for you to keep that appointment with him. He loves you. He wants you to be born of his spirit so that you can be a child of God. Cleansed from all sin and infilled by the very spirit of God. And Father, I pray this morning if there is one person who walked into this congregation not knowing you as Savior, even now, by your spirit, you would tug at their heart, Lord. Cause them to know that they need to make this stand for Jesus this morning. That Jesus is beckoning them. He's saying, behold, I stand at the door of your heart. If you're hearing my voice and you will just open your heart, he says, I will come into you and I'll have sweet fellowship with you as father and son or father and daughter. So if you're here this morning, you don't know this Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, why don't you just be bold enough and raise your hand so that we can help you into a simple prayer that will make all the difference in your life. Is there one person that will say, yes, Lord Jesus, you love me, you died for me. Yes, sir, I see your hand. Praise God for you. Is there another that will join with this gentleman and say, yes, I wanted Jesus Christ to come into my heart this morning. Just raise your hand so you can put your hand down. Is there another? Under the balcony? In the balcony? It's one simple prayer away. And the miracle will take place in your life and you will know it. The Spirit of God will identify with your spirit that something supernatural took place this morning. And you will know that you are born of the Spirit of God. One more time, is there another besides this gentleman? Well, I'm going to take it that we are all born of the Spirit of God, but just in the event, apart from this gentleman, just in the event that that is not your case, I beg you, with all that is within me, don't let another opportunity pass. You don't know. You have no hold on tomorrow. You don't even have a hold on this evening, the way things are going in Trinidad now. So, sir, would you come, please? I'm going to lead you in a simple prayer. I want you to close your eyes so you're not distracted. I want you to not even think about me, just think about Jesus Christ who loves you and gave his very life for you. And he wants to put his spirit in you by your invitation to him to come in. Okay? So I'm going to help you with a prayer. You pray it to him and pray it out. Dear God in heaven, I come to you this morning, a sinner in need of a Savior. I believe with all my heart that you, Jesus, gave your life for me. I believe with all my heart you rose from the dead. And I now accept you, Jesus, as my Savior. I confess you, Jesus, as my Lord. Lord Jesus, forgive me of all my sins. Come into my heart. Put your spirit in me and teach me to live for you. By faith, I receive you into my heart, Lord Jesus. And I thank you for saving me. Amen. Precious Lord Jesus, the angels in heaven must be rejoicing. For you said, when one sinner comes to you, they rejoice. I pray, wonderful Savior, that this man will experience your spirit being witness with his spirit this morning, that he has been born a child of God by virtue of the confession that he has made. I pray, Lord, that every unclean spirit that holds this man captive, that this morning every chain, Lord, every chain will be broken by the power of the blood of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. This man would be set free from every dominion, every domination of unclean spirits that are holding him in bondage. Precious Lord, we thank you this morning that your blood has all power to bring about every change that is necessary in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. So, as a gentleman. God bless you richly. You may be seated.